Well, this is our third week into the book of Acts, and the emphasis was definitely on the kingdom of God. Just a quick summary of the beginning of Acts, and this is kind of foundational. After Jesus resurrected, he stayed on earth for about 40 days, and during this time, his disciples met with resurrected Jesus and listened to his teaching, which was mainly focused on about what the kingdom of God is. So Jesus proclaimed the gospel of the kingdom of God, and after his resurrection, you know, well, he could have talked about a lot of issues, but his main focus was this is what the kingdom of God is, and this is what's going to happen. Okay, so his main training for 40 days after his resurrection was on the topic of the kingdom of God. And last week, it's something that, you know, in our Christian community, we're so used to. Jesus is king, you know, the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, and everything like that. But what does it imply? The implication means Jesus is not only our Savior, so that when we believe in Jesus, we not only go to heaven. Jesus is our Lord. He's our Messiah. He's Christ. He's King, meaning we are under his lordship. And Jesus defines his family as, you know, my family is people who are with me and who obey my will. So the core of being a Christian means you accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior, means that we are, you know, saved people from sin. And therefore, our life now is under the authority of Jesus, who is King. And so our life here, until the coming of the fulfillment of his kingdom, we are to live under his will. So we should be trained to know God's will. We should allow the Spirit who indwells in us to empower us to live the kingdom life and obey. So the core of our Christian life should be about are we really clear on discerning what God is trying to tell us, right? And what is God's will? What does the whole scripture, you know, that he had already revealed to us, his plans, his will, the way of a Christian life, the way of the people of God, you know, and how should we live? You know, everything is here. And are we really striving to live under his lordship? Okay, and that's what last week's sermon is about. Today we're gonna keep on. Okay, let's go to the narrative and see how it applies to us. This is right before Jesus' ascension. You know, he's staying for 40 days with the disciples. Main teaching topic was the kingdom of God. And then this is this last moment, right before his ascension, right? And it starts with verse 6. The disciples and Jesus, they met together, and they asked this question. And in this question, we could see, wow, for 40 days, Jesus, resurrected Jesus, was with them, ate with them, basically taught for 40 days about the kingdom of God. And in this question, we could see they still don't get it. In this question alone, we could see that they don't get it. And this is true because we know when the Spirit reveals it to us. The disciples only know when Jesus reveals to them. So I'm kind of confused here. Yeah? I mean, if you are teaching about the same topic for about 40 days, they should have got it. But no, they didn't. Okay, this is what their question was. They asked, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? We could say, well, it's a valid question. No, Jesus is talking about the kingdom of God. And yeah, they were asking, is it now? Is it now? Is what all you talked about, is it now? Well, Jesus is saying, okay, why is it that you're asking me, I'm going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Because their concept of kingdom of God is condensed in this question. Jesus' concept of the kingdom was the whole world. It's the whole universe. Their understanding of God's kingdom is us, only Israel. We're under the rule of Rome Empire, and you know, for hundreds of years, we hadn't have our own country. We want, you know, the Davidic kingdom coming back. We want to have this power again. So when is your kingdom going to be restored to Israel so that our people can now rule the world? Okay. They got it wrong. It's not about the kingdom of Israel. It's about the kingdom of God. And Jesus is here to restore the kingdom. And even though Jesus taught them, they kind of understood it in their own concepts. And I think this is what we always do. Okay? We read scripture, we say we meditate on it, but then, you know, within our own boundaries of understanding, you know, we bring meaning to it. Well, sometimes it's good, but sometimes it's not good enough. The Spirit has to reveal what the true intention of God is. And mainly, this is always, always out of our thinking boundaries. That's why the gospel is so powerful. They were thinking only about the restoration of the kingdom of Israel. But Jesus is saying this. It's not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. Jesus is saying, wrong question. Your focus should not be about when. It should be about how God's kingdom that Jesus had been teaching for 40 days, how this will be realized in our lives. And the answer is verse 8. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea, not only Israel, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. This is the boundary of the kingdom of God. And this is how this kingdom is going to start. So Jesus is focusing on this last question right before his ascension. You know, it's like 40 days ended, and it could have been a test, but the disciples asked the questions, this question, when, which is resulting in they still haven't got it fully. Okay, and because they asked this question, Jesus reveals to us how his kingdom is going to start, and the totality of where it's going to head to. It's not about restoring the kingdom of Israel. It's not giving the kingdom to Israel. It's giving, it's restoring the kingdom of God. It's always about giving the lordship to our true king, who is Jesus Christ, right? And we see that after this, Jesus, he was taken up from their very eyes, and the cloud hid him from their sight. And they were looking at it. Okay, so this was a public ascension so that all the disciples knew Jesus left. Why is this important? And why does Acts have it here? Because Jesus' ascension is very, very important in what Jesus taught about the kingdom and about the coming of the Holy Spirit. In John, before the crucifixion of Jesus, before the passion, Jesus talked with his disciples. This is going to be his last time fellowship and eating with the disciples. And in this long dialogue of what is going to happen, Jesus says in chapter 16, verse 7 of John, "But I tell you the truth, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you." So Jesus is basically saying, I gotta go so that the counselor, who is the Holy Spirit, can come to you. And looking at Jesus' promise here, it is only when the Holy Spirit comes that the reality of the kingdom will be with you. Okay? So Jesus had to go so that the Holy Spirit could come. And Jesus said, after his many days of teaching about the kingdom of God, you know what? Wait until the kingdom of God will initiate with the pouring of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus ascended. And we focus mainly on the death of Jesus. He died for our sins. He's a savior, right? And so a lot of people want to emphasize his resurrection. That means we are giving a new life. Jesus is the first fruit of the resurrection, meaning he showed us what a resurrected life would look like, okay? He showed us that a new life will be given to all believers who died with Christ and resurrected with Christ. We are a new creation. We are a life-producing spirit, okay, who is indwelling with us. And therefore, when we gather together, the Lord's Spirit will manifest into many ways, showing the grace, love, compassion, healing, power of the Lord. That's who we are, right? But Christ's ascension is also very important. Christ's incarnation, his life here, his teaching, his death, his resurrection, his ascension is all crucial in understanding the whole gospel and the implication that what it means to us. Because Christ ascended, now the Holy Spirit comes to us. And, you know, when we do worship, we always do the Apostles' Creed, right? What does it say about the ascension? We confess, he ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. What does this mean? Christ's ascension means that, yes, he is truly now the king. He is now given all authority. Okay. This is how powerful Christ is. That's why in Matthew 28, 18, okay, this is when Jesus is ascending, he says to the disciples, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." Okay? So when we pray in Jesus' name, we should believe that he has all authority. Okay? Don't lack faith in praying, "Oh, Jesus, you know, who was a nice person 2,000 years ago, who walked around Galilee, you know, performing miracles only to those people." Okay? His authority today is still here. And when we call upon his name, when we pray in the name of Jesus, his authority, power, you know, is with us. When we believe and when it is his will. So even in Philippians chapter 2, it describes about the heart of the mind of Christ, and it describes about his incarnation and his, you know, going up to heaven again. Let me read that part. Verse 8 to 11, Philippians chapter 2. "And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place So it talks about, you know, the resurrection and the ascension is kind of one, okay? We do know that after his resurrection, 40 days and then the ascension. But here it's like, this is kind of like a creed within the ancient church that Paul is kind of referring to. The resurrection is not just, you know, wow, he's alive again. It continues with the ascension, okay? Jesus is truly the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. He's given all authority. And here it says, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. This is the realm of Christ's rule and authority. He's truly king. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he's king, to the glory of God the Father, right? This is what it means when Christ ascends and he sits at the right hand of God. It means that he is truly Lord over everything and that he has all authority. So Acts, it begins with Christ talking about the kingdom of God and that he is going to restore the kingdom, okay, by being Lord. And to do that, he had to ascend because this is like Christ is Lord, okay? And all authority is given to him. And for us, the benefit is, we now receive the Holy Spirit. Okay. So the next thing that we could think about is the kingdom of God. It talks about, the question that the disciples ask is, are you going to restore the kingdom? They ask this question because when Jesus was talking about the kingdom, he talked about it. We don't have it in scripture, but based on the question, he talked about the restoration of the kingdom. But they kind of reduced it to restore the kingdom to Israel, okay? Maybe a Davidic kingdom or something like that. But Jesus talked about, yeah, I'm going to restore by being Lord. And this had been, you know, the plan for us from the beginning. Okay, we have to grasp that. Okay, I hope that everybody here is reading scripture again from Genesis. And from the beginning of Genesis, we see creation, right? And when God created man and woman, he gave them a command. Let's go to that part. Genesis chapter 1, verses 27 to 28. It says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Okay. If we're thinking about the kingdom, if you read this scripture, the only word, okay, that kind of ties in with the kingdom is rule. Do you understand that when God created us, he, from the beginning, made us co-rulers of this earth? He wanted us to rule because we were formed in the image of God. God rules. God rules with love, compassion. God rules with life. And he, when he created us, he wanted us to be like him and rule, okay? And be fruitful in life. So this is the command that God gave to man from the beginning. And right after this, you go to chapter 2 and then to chapter 3, and we see the fall of man. right? Sin comes in. So this ruling, you know, we now have this kind of negative understanding. Rule? No one rules me, you know. we don't like this word, okay? I'm not under anybody, okay? We want freedom or something like that. It became a negative word. Why? Because fallen man, okay? By the influence of sin, we rule not for life, not for benefiting other creatures, not to restoring the life fullness of God's creation, but for our own sinful desires, okay? So after the fall of man, it's all about I. Okay, somebody says sin is in the middle, I. Okay, everything is about me. My desires have to be full. Therefore, I'm going to rule. I'm going to do it my way. My way is the highway. It's all about me, okay? That's why there's clashings, wars, disputes, conflicts, hate, and everything. Because it's not benefiting anyone except for the person who wants to dominate and rule. That is the history of our civilization. And even today, we want to rule. We want to rule. We want Christ out. We want to rule. So when God deals with this sin, it's not just about I'm saved. I was a sinner. I was doomed to die, but now Christ saved. It's not about that. It's about restoring God's kingdom again. It's bringing back the new Eden. And the only way to do that is to reconnect with God. And to do that, God had to deal with our sins. And we know how God dealt with his sin. Jesus died for our sins. There's judgment for our sins. And now we are reconnect with God, whoever believes in that. And then now, God is Lord again. So it's the restoration of Eden. Okay, God wants this back. The command that God gave us now changed into, okay, rule over all creation. And in order to do that, go to all peoples, proclaim the gospel, so they hear and they too will come back to me because their sins are dealt with. And now their life, their lordship is to their allegiance to Christ. And through that kingdom rule, you will produce life. You will give back to the world. You will restore to them the original creation, right? This is what God is thinking of when he's saying the kingdom of God. Before the fall, before Adam and Eve sinned, before their break with their relationship with God, with one another, with the world, when we come back in the name of Christ, his saving grace, his death on the cross, his resurrection leads us to new life, flourishing life. And the Holy Spirit is the life-giving Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the initiator of God's kingdom that would be realized here until the full consummation of his kingdom. That's where we are. This is the meaning of the restoration of his kingdom, okay? So it has a bigger impact and influence than with our narrow understanding of I believe in Christ, I go to heaven, I'm saved. Do you know that we are co-rulers if we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord? It's not my words. In Revelations chapter 26, this is like 21-22, it's new heavens and new earth. This is like the new Eden, okay, finally restored, which is, you know, the fulfillment of the kingdom of God. It says here, blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection, meaning us. Now, we have part in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Okay. Do you know that Christ saved us? And under his lordship, that we are also going to co-reign with Christ. The first death, the first resurrection is about our being saved. Okay, and you have that in Romans chapter 6, verses 4 to 5. Let me read this. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death. Okay, so when we're baptized, we go into the water. We're dead with Christ. Just as Christ was raised from the dead, we come out of the water, a new creation with a new life. Okay? From the dead, from the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. So Christ's resurrection gives us new life. Not only that, co-rulers of his kingdom. Because we submit to his will, because we discern his will, and because the authority that is given to his name, we proclaim in faith the power and authority of the name of Jesus. And that's why when we proclaim his name, power is shown, realized within our community too. When we pray in the name of Jesus, do you know we're exerting his authority in the name of Christ? Do we understand that we are co-rulers in his kingdom? Therefore, what is the task of the church? What should we do? Where are we headed now? Looking into this deep meaning of the kingdom of God, me as a pastor, I think I have been so focused on the saving grace of our Lord and sometimes emphasizing on the resurrection of Christ. I've so underdealt with the concept of his rule, his dominion, and how great, you know, this is a blessing to any believer. And how sad it is to really think that we, always calling Jesus, Jesus Christ, meaning Jesus King, Jesus Messiah, Jesus our Lord, that we haven't really learned to live under the lordship of Christ. Therefore, the realization of his kingdom, which should be experienced within our community, is not truly really experienced. And if this goes on for quite a while, we get to think, maybe this is the norm. Okay, maybe this is it. Looking into scripture, looking into the teaching of Jesus, looking into Acts, Jesus is saying, I'm going to ascend. I will have all authority. I will send my spirit. So my church, you will show to the world and give them a taste of heaven. You will show to the world the power of my authority. And you will go to the ends of the earth, because when I'm coming back, okay, men of Galilee, Why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. Meaning, Christ's kingdom will be fulfilled with the second coming. And for us, living in the already initiated kingdom, and also hoping for the not yet consummation of the kingdom, the church is given a task to live like kingdom people, experience it here, and also be witnesses to the world that yes, Christ reigns. So here it says, you will be witnesses. Okay? The original Greek is martus, meaning that, you know, it has the root martyr. Okay? It means witness, yes. But it also means that we are going to lay our life down because this is so true. That the gospel of the kingdom of God is so true that I will, yes, lay down my life, just as Christ did, to preach the message that, yes, Christ saves and he rules. And his kingdom has started and we should join because his kingdom will be fulfilled. And we are witnesses to this beautiful message of the kingdom of God. Brothers and sisters, I want to conclude with, let's remember that we have this task as the body of Christ, as a church. And so, to fulfill this task, while given our time, resources, relationships here, we should really focused on, am I really living the life as Christ as my true king? Is Christ's lordship influencing every aspect of my life? Not only my church relationship, in our family, our workplaces, wherever. Is Christ reigning? And am I using his name, the authority that is given in his name, am I praying for the expansion of his kingdom so that the life that has been given to me will go to the ends of the earth? Okay, so not everyone can go to the ends of the earth. So expanding our life, expanding our relationship, and within that, are there areas where Christ is not actually ruling? Am I really praying with the authority giving in me, to me, in the name and power of Jesus? Am I praying that that realm, that relationship, that aspect of whatever that I see, is it in the dominion of Christ? And are we truly experiencing the taste of the heaven that is going to be fulfilled here within the body of Christ? And if not, am I really praying to and asking passionately for God to really rule within our community? And are we seeing this relationship, you know, bringing life, healing, restoration within our limited relationship that we have with one another? The book of Acts is not stories and wonders that happened 2,000 years ago. It's a book that is challenging us. Are we living the life of the book of Acts? Are we living the life as people, families of God in the kingdom, are we truly experiencing His rule? And I think this is something that we should really pray about. Let's respond in prayer. So remember in Scripture, after the 40 days, disciples asked the question, focusing on their misunderstanding of the concept of the kingdom of God. What is our concept of the kingdom of God? Maybe you use it in prayer. Maybe we use it in our dialogue with one another. But are we really experiencing this in our real life? Is Christ really ruling? And is the filling of the Holy Spirit within us so that this will be the power that expands the kingdom of God within us? What are the realms that we see that is not Christ's rule right now? What are the relationships? What are the thoughts? What are our life patterns where Christ does not rule? This should be our focus in prayer. And how about our church? Are we experiencing the kingdom life that God has lavishly poured upon us and expect us to live within? Let's not make our own understanding and experience become the concept of God's kingdom, but let His concept, which is from the very beginning to the end, to Revelation, His vision of restoring His kingdom. Let's respond to Him in prayer. Father God, we ask that every aspect of our life, You reign. May Your kingdom come and Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Empower us with the Holy Spirit so that in our everyday life, relationship, work, wherever it may be, that we see the realization of Your kingdom. We have a taste of what Your kingdom would look like. Help us and open our eyes to see those realms that are not under Your lordship. And we ask that Your will be done and that You reign as Lord, as King, as Messiah, as Christ. Help us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.